The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this occasion by Big Ross Hauser. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Thank you for having me on. Been looking forward to this.
Me too. I'm saying that right. It is Hauser, isn't it? It's nothing.
That's it, yes.
Excellent. That's fine. I've nailed all these name pronunciations, except Jarek Novak, who was on a couple of weeks ago in this timeline order, and I said his name wrong every time, and then he corrected me off the recording afterwards, and I was like, now I look like the idiot. But anyway, how you doing?
I'm doing well, thank you. Yeah, not much to report at the moment.
It's usually my first question. You said you listened to a couple of episodes, and my first question is always the same. But I thought, why mix it up for a change? As we're on the run off to season three, why not change the opening question to that? But the first one generally is the same. How'd you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment that got you hooked on pro wrestling?
Well, I used to go to a lot of jumbo sales when I was a kid, and I got in about late 99, I got SummerSlam 97 on VHS. And I forgot to rewind it all the way back, so I've only seen the main event. And I was really drawn to the characters in that, like Bret Hart, Undertaker, Shawn Michaels.
Was that Undertaker, Bret Hart main event with Shawn Michaels the referee?
That was it, yeah. And I'm kind of thankful I didn't see the match before that. Stone Cold and Owen Hart.
Oh, yeah. So whoever bought that VHS must have saw that and went, no, that's for me. That's plenty. I'll just leave it at that now.
Yeah, must have put them off that recording.
Did you go back and eventually watch it all?
I've seen it many times now. And then, because that was in late 99, I've got to see Royal Rumble 2000. That was on Channel 5 that year. Never got to see it live. I recorded that in a VHS as well. And yeah, I was thinking, where's the three guys that were in that match there? Why are they not in this? So obviously then I found out WCW, and I think Undertaker was just taking a hiatus. And Shawn Michaels' back injury.
Well, weird time. That's probably about time I got into it. So I'm absolutely on board with where you're at. But yeah, to go from, like you say, watching that and then seeing it, for me, it was like I got a Draws action figure, and then by the time I got it and started watching WWF, Draws was gone. He got injured and he was paralyzed. So I had this amazing figure. I never saw Draws wrestle until like a long time afterwards, seeing him. So. A pretty good way to get into that. Bret Hart, Undertaker, and Shawn Michaels. Taker being a bigger guy as well. It's
shortly after that, I've managed to go to my first house show. That was in SECC in 2002. And looking back, I wish I'd been a bigger fan of wrestling at the time, so I could appreciate it more. Because like the main event was Triple H and Ric Flair against Undertaker and William Regal.
Really random pairing.
Then like Mr. Perfect was on the show, Stone Cold was on it, Eddie Guerrero was against Jeff Hardy for the Intercontinental, I think.
Oh man. It's one of those things where you look back on shows that you've seen in live and then you think you didn't appreciate it at the time, and then you come back now and you go, oh man, you'd kill to see Jeff Hardy versus Eddie Guerrero. Now it would be incredible. Of course you can't, but it would be incredible to see it as well. So your first favorite then would have been, I guess, those guys in the main event, Bret, Undertaker, Shawn. By 2002, then, who were you kind of rooting for? Who were your favourites then?
Well, I liked Kane back then. Then, is like after Royal Rumble 2001, obviously Rock and Stone Cold. I was more of a Rock guy. Who else? I liked Triple H and APA. They were going then.
Nice. Any particular, like, I don't know how he pops up so often, but like Steve Blackman, any kind of like random ones in the hardcore division around about that time, anyone that you like I don't know, my example would be like Scotty Tuhati. So a guy who's never going to be the WWF champion, but you're like buzzing to see him come out and do the worm. And any kind of your, maybe, what do they call it, your boys, any of your boys it's put.
Well, on that show, I remember, I think Crash Holly left with the hardcore title. I think it changed about 20 times that night.
That's a perfect example of a boy. So that's what, 2002, early 2000s. How did your wrestling habit, did you take a break? Did you take any hiatus from it? Or are you all in on wrestling from that point forward?
Well, I took a break in like 2004. So 2006, I think it was. Because I just discovered more of life, and you know, as wrestling's not cool when you're in school. Yeah. Especially when you get to like 15, 16 years old.
Yeah, a lot of friends went by the wayside at that point. I unfortunately carried on and became the weird wrestling kid. So, you know, you earn things, earn your stripes at that point. But was there anything like between that time, like growing up and becoming cool and wrestling wasn't part of it? Did you do things like backyarding? Was that any stuff when you were growing up with your friends? Anything like that? Did you have a character?
Well, when I was in the boys' brigade, we had a vaulting horse and a crash mat, so used to do loads of wrestling moves to each other. And because I was bigger than them all, I just was able to pick them up and do whatever I wanted with them at the time.
But was it being bigger?
Not much has changed.
yeah, absolutely. So for being bigger, did that kind of gravitate towards guys like your Kane, like your Undertaker, because these are just big guys being able to manhandle quote unquote smaller guys? Because when you see these smaller guys up close, they're not small.
Yeah, it did actually. Yeah, like Undertaker's my all time favourite. Then like Kane as well. Then surprise one, maybe JBL/Bradshaw. I've always liked him.
I think that's evident from your kind of style now of the hard hitting, just blasting folk.
Yeah.
So you go from that, 60, you've stopped watching wrestling for a little bit. What brought you back in? What was there a WrestleMania, a Royal Rumble that was on, and you were like, oh, I remember wrestling, I'll watch this again. What brought you back?
It was the Royal Rumble 2006, because I heard that Eddie Guerrero died. Obviously, it's the anniversary of that now. And they were dedicating the Royal Rumble to that, I think, at the time. Then I watched it and Rey Mysterio won, which I never thought would happen. Then the match at that WrestleMania, Undertaker Kurt Angle at that No Way Out was one that started to draw me back in. Then WrestleMania 22, I think that was.
Right, I'll just double check. I'll get the old Wikipedia out.
One with Cena, Triple H, and Edge and Mick Foley.
Oh yeah, it is. I don't need to search that. Yeah, it's WrestleMania 22. Yeah, that's an underappreciated WrestleMania just for that match.
Yeah.
Those matches alone. So yeah, no way, bad way. That's so weird timing then. Yeah, it's been 16 years since Eddie Guerrero passed away, pretty much to the day, and here we are chatting about it. And it was Eddie Guerrero's legacy that kind of brought you back into watching wrestling itself, and seeing that. Coming in at Royal Rumble 2006, it's probably a bit like you come in because Eddie Guerrero's passed away and you want to see what's happening now and how they're honoring him. And then of course had the whole Eddie isn't in heaven kind of storyline with Orton and Rey Mysterio. You're thinking, oh, maybe not, wrestling's not the best thing. And then that year, of course, He Who Must Not Be Named did stuff that year as well. So it's a strange year to come back into it, but it kind of plows all this wrestling nostalgia back onto you, and also all the weird stuff around about it. So at this point, you would have missed JBL pretty much, because that was
I missed his entire title reign, but obviously I've seen it all back, and I missed him. No, I just caught him, Eddie Guerrero and Brock Lesnar, I think.
That would be Eddie winning the title, and then of course then that would have transitioned into him and JBL and some absolute brutal matches as well. So again, is that timing thing very? It's unbelievable that JBL is one of your favorites, and you just missed this whole biggest run ever at the time to watch it live. Going back on it, were we always kind of keeping tabs at all, or like sneaking on WWE.com? Or
I would check WWE.com, and I never had Sky or anything back then, so yeah, I would still watch some of the big pay per views.
Or you knew a guy.
If some of my friends wanted to watch it and get an invite, sure, why not?
Did you have to play it cool, like going, oh, if you're watching it, I'll come over, but really you just went, I'm watching some wrestling?
I guess, yeah.
So how did you go from watching... Again, one of my questions I ask everyone: how did you go from watching wrestling to pursuing it? So, did you watch indie wrestling in Scotland? How did you discover that, and how did you get to doing it?
Well, I didn't know there was indie wrestling in Scotland until my friend asked me, "Do you want to come and watch the Royal Rumble at the garage?" That this was Royal Rumble that had CM Punk and Rock at it, and. Okay. And it was like, yeah, okay. Like, oh, but there's a Scottish wrestling show before it. Well, okay, let's go and see that. And it was the second annual Square Go from ICW.
Not a bad way to get in a rumble in general. Second annual Square Go. I think I know who won it, and I don't know if we can actually talk about that. So second annual Square Go, see who... Nope. Red Lightning versus Stevie Boy. We can mention that. God damn you, speaking next. Johnny Moss, Christopher. I was mixing up who it was.
Johnny Moss was the first wrestler that I ever seen in a Scottish wrestling show. And I thought, oh God, maybe he's big. I don't think I'll be going near wrestling anytime. And then Christopher comes out and no offense to him, but it was like, maybe there is a chance.
If you do see Johnny Moss out first, you're thinking, wow, this Scottish wrestling scene's humongous, this is just bodybuilders. And then again, same as yourself, no offense to him, but yeah, Christopher coming out and he's quite a bit smaller and skinnier especially at the time. And so did that kind of get something in your head going, well, I've seen this little guy could do it. I'm a bit bigger than him. I like the wrestling. Do you think, oh, maybe I could do this? But that's quite a big jump between that and GPWA. So how did you go from that point forward?
Well, it was always in the back of my mind. So I always just thought, I'll try it sometime if something comes up, and I never did. And then those same friends that invited me to that just pointed me towards GPWA, and then we joined the second intake. And I was only one of the three of us that got through the intake. And I just kept going with it.
So checking who you would have been on that first show to see, you would have seen, of course, Red Lightning, Wolfgang.
These I think Jack Gessler was in the final two of that Square Go.
And of course, BT Gunn's in there as well. So pretty much everyone that would have been taking you in that intake, you would have seen wrestle at least once. What was it like going in that first day then? Was there any intimidation because you've seen all these guys and they've done absolute nuts things in the ring, or was it just a case of just getting in and getting stuck in?
There was a wee bit of nerves there. Always is trying something new. And like I thought, I'm quite fit. I'm sure I'll be okay at this. And then I'll go in and the first day I'm not. It takes me a few weeks to get going. And then it's all kind of plain sailing from then.
So as I'm guessing you're one of the least taller guys in your intake. So was you said the first couple of weeks you need to get going. Was there did they take into account more adjustments to where you could be placed because of your height? You could what was your kind of actually no, I'll ask that question second. But the first one being so the first couple of weeks that you're finding a bit of a struggle, was it more of a you didn't think it was going to be as difficult as it was when you went in? Do you think it was a bit more cardio led and squats and all that kind of stuff that you thought, oh, I didn't think I need to do this much straight away? Or what was your kind of first thoughts on it?
Well, the squats did take me by surprise. Yeah. And yeah, after the first day running the ropes, my back was bruised, as everyone's, I'm sure. I mean, I just wasn't very coordinated. That was the main thing.
Yeah, you do read or see the videos of special William Regal shouting about left foot and leading by your left foot. Outside of that, so you said you're a bit fit. You're fit. What was your kind of background? Did you do anything like a sport, football, rugby? I'm assuming that just because your height, rugby might have been there somewhere. But was there a sporting background going into it?
Yeah, I played rugby until I was 16. Maybe it's not 17. I stopped when I was 17. Then I played as a number 8 there. At, somewhere called Carthar Queen's Park. And I played football with my friends every week and went to the gym regularly at the time.
Okay, so even though the coordination wasn't all there, you weren't afraid to get hurt, kind of thing. Especially rugby, it's not a delicate sport in general. I was saying about the taking into account your height. So you're coming in with guys like a Lionheart and a Jack Jester, and these are taller, Wolfgang as well, bigger guys. Were they able to kind of lead you into any particular drills to accommodate your height at all, or are you just doing the same thing as everyone else?
They were all very, very helpful. A few of them took me aside by myself and helped me get help me do some of the things. Although I actually wasn't the biggest guy in that class, because Flex Hunter was in that class.
Oh, the man, the myth, the legend. Mm-hmm. Flex Hunter, of course. All right, so at least there's two of you, these two horses, mm-hmm. that could square off every so often. As far as anyone else in your class that's still active or at least got onto shows at all?
Thatcher Wright.
Well, they can't all be winners. The one that went out tonight as we were recording was with Thatcher, and I've never wanted to hit a guest before, and it was just, it was phenomenal. I was watching in the back going, I look furious at this whole interview, and he's got a very good talent, this Thatcher Wright. I don't know how he's going to cope in front of a whole bar of lands. At this point, it would have passed, but I don't know if he's going to cope with that, if he'll make it out alive, so to speak. But yeah, so Thatcher Wright then. And when you went into the second part of the intake, were you kind of put in with some of the other folk, or were they already moved on to like the next stage?
We were in with a few of the other folk, yeah. And by that point, I started to get better at it. So,
and I've got your debut down 2017 against Soldato, that's what Cage Match has. And I always worry that I think there's a gala at some point that's absolutely missed that out of
it. There was a few galas actually. My full debut, maybe it was in a rumble in Alexandra Park. And I actually won it by eliminating Wolfgang and Lionheart at the same time.
Not a bad start then. That should be the debut. Cool. I mean, Soldato is great, but the debut should be eliminating Wolfgang and Lionheart in a rumble. So Alexandra Park then, go back to there. What was it like getting in front of a crowd for the first time then? Where did you find out, and did you have gear ready? Just what was this experience like?
Well, they didn't really tell us until a week before it. Then I had to buy gear off Amazon for that. I think it's on YouTube somewhere. I think just GPWA, Battle Royal, Alexandra Park. Or something like that. I got battered by the two of them when it was just the three of us in there. Wolfgang chopped me, which I've never seen him do since.
It was like your initiation process there, just getting paying your dues, I think that's what it's called, isn't it?
Yeah, I was down. And they were both trying to eliminate each other, and I just came up behind them and put them both over the rope.
So if working in front of a crowd then, that would have been, I'm guessing, outside of like other trainees being in training matches, this would have been your first time in front of an audience. I suppose it's not a bad way to start off with you going in front of people that generally, if it's a gala show, they're not here to see the wrestling. So they're not going to know if things go wrong or anything like that. But what was it like getting just seeing a crowd coming to watch you wrestle in your Amazon bot gear? What was that like?
It was quite daunting at first. But then I feel like as soon as you're in the ring, it's over in a flash. It goes at a million miles an hour. And half the time, I'm not sure what's happening.
So after that, of course, then, like I say, your full debut was against Soldato. That'll be your first proper test then, because, of course, in a gala, it's a battle royal. There's a lot you have to do, but again, at the same time, there's not, because there's so many people there until the end. What was it like actually getting your first full debut in front of, again, this time a paying audience, so they're coming to actually see wrestling with Soldato? What was your thoughts on that?
It was enjoyable. That one was more enjoyable, I feel, maybe because the crowd are actually there to see wrestling. And I enjoyed being in the ring with Soldato, although that was the time that I discovered that I was very good at throwing a clothesline. There's a picture out there of me hitting Soldato, and you can just see the dent in his chest at the time.
At that point, I think if I remember right, the photo, it's your black trunks and everything. So you're pretty much looking like JBL. So is that the kind of inspiration just behind the whole look and the big clothesline? And was your look Bradshaw inspired?
I never thought it at the time, but it was, I guess subconsciously, it was.
Just like just no nonsense, no flash, just coming here, battering you, and then leaving kind of thing. Again, going through your first couple of matches, of course, after that was the Sam Barber experience, and then you had a match with The Purge. So these are all guys now that, are names that you see popping up all over the place, but this time this would have been their first. I mean, they would have been on shows maybe a little bit beforehand. How are you finding, like, trying to get the crowd to support you and things like that? You come across as very quiet and not an unreserved, and a reserved person. So how did you find trying to get the crowd on your side? Did you feel that they were quite taken with you when you started coming out and batting folk with big moves and big clotheslines?
Well, I was a bad guy at the time for those matches. So I guess it was, it did work, because big guy beating up smaller guys is usually going to get over on family shows like that.
And then, of course, you teamed with Danny Cantrell for a bit. Of course, he went on to be in The Grind, if I remember rightly. So you've gone from a couple of singles matches and then a little bit of tag team. Have you got a preference, or did you find that was a good kind of learning experience operating a tag match?
Yeah, it was a good learning experience, because I'd say the Purge are one of the probably the best tag team to come out of GPWA. Just to learn about the structure of a tag match and things like that was good, and more chance to learn how to be in front of a crowd.
Yeah, you don't. Not until this year I realised that there's so much kind of extra work and rules to a tag team match, and it's one of those underappreciated skills to be able to do. And if you're getting out to do it, then even better. So I've got other matches. You had likes with Paxo, who again he's a bit slender, but he's about he's a taller guy. So this has been one of the first proper times. I suppose Stevie James as well, he's quite tall, but it would have been the first kind of time you've been in a ring with someone about your height and ability. You're not going to be able to throw them about as easy as some others. So what was it like getting in with Paxo? And actually, I want to add to that, Eli Bulwark, who would have been the September that year as well. So these are two different matches, but it's two big guys facing off. Was that something new and something that you're quite excited to get stuck into?
I was quite excited about that match. Paxo has been doing it for a few years in around Europe as well, obviously. And to be in that kind of match, not just have the usual formula of big guy, wee guy, it was good to explore more of that in both of those matches, actually.
So when you're getting in the ring with either way, these matches, do you get homework on what matches to watch to maybe get some ideas of how to structure it? Or is it so for likes of a Soldato might watch Rey Mysterio against whoever, Undertaker, just throwing that out, just that kind of dynamic to see if you could pluck some bits of it, and then you see an Eli versus yourself, Undertaker again. Undertaker and Kane, just two big guys going at it. Is there any kind of matches that you try and go back to and pick out some little bits and moves that you can add to your own matches?
Yeah, not given any other. I look at do some research of what type of certain wrestlers with certain types of opponents. I did actually watch an Undertaker Rey Mysterio match for the Soldato one, the Royal Rumble, 2009, was it?
Yeah, it was. I think I'm remembering. I remember a few they had briefly. I can't remember when, but yeah, we'll go with that. 2009. I'll go with your memory on it. Yeah, so that's a pretty good way to get bits and pieces of that. And then, of course, 2019 rolls around. You have some matches here and there, and then of course in June, kind of the GPWA team and Scottish wrestling and wrestling in general kind of gets rocked with Lionheart passing away, and you end up going down to Preston to be part of their tribute show. So we're not gonna. I've spoke to so many of our guys for GPWA now, so we're not going to like labor on because it is a sad thing. We're not going to say it's not. But what was your memories of training with Lionheart, and what was his legacy to yourself and your own development?
Well, he was a good trainer. He was hard on you, but that's because he cared about, right? Because he cared about us. And he gave us all several chances on his pro wrestling elite shows. I was in a few of his pre-show matches, which I'm grateful for. And, he always wanted to have a laugh in training as well.
And going down to Preston with the team, and were you part of that show as well? Was it a rumble?
We were all in a rumble. GPWA guys versus Preston guys.
And being able to kind of do that as tribute for Lionheart, was that a little bit of I don't know, cathartic, just being able to show your appreciation, but do it in wrestling form.
Yeah, it was good, as someone said on that night. It was would have been what he wanted for us all to get opportunities out of such an unfortunate event.
Absolutely. And then of course that same year you end up in down in Target. Got my geography all but I end up down in Target with Levi Justice at the time and Ravy Davey. So what was it like? So GPWA would be your home promotion or Wrestling Experience Scotland, I don't know what to call it at this point, but Target, of course, would have been your first proper outside booking, PCW notwithstanding, and PWE, of course, but that's all kind of connected to Lionheart. So Target's new. What was it like being told that you what was it like getting the call to go down to Target, and what were your thoughts on being performing in front of a new audience in general?
With Target, I'd always heard good things about Target. It was one I always wanted to go to, and then to get the call, it was quite short notice actually. I got the call, I think it was like early that morning, and then I just went down to Carlisle, and didn't even know what the match was going to be at the time. And turned out it was me, Ravy Davey, and Levi, and turned out to be one of the most enjoyable matches I can remember having.
Is it one of those where if you're nervous like for a match or anxious, would you prefer it that you were just told, right, you've got a match now so you don't have time to worry about it? Or are you the kind of person that if you don't know what's happening, you're just gonna get more worried about it? You'd rather have a bit more time to kind of prepare. What's your kind of style when it comes to that?
Well, there's a. I don't dislike either of them. If you've got a match that you know about, you can do some research on it, as you spoke about before. But it's not knowing you've got a match and then finding out on the day is just as good, in my opinion.
So especially if you're in the ring with the likes of Ravy Davey and Levi, Davey especially is just this like charisma magnet who can just whip a crowd into a frenzy either whichever way he decides to go for. So at least you're the having to adjust to working with the crowd is taken a little bit away from you because like not say he'll do all the work, but he's got most of it covered. You just need to be able to just do your part of it all as well. For that. So yeah, I mean, and then after that, of course, you matched with Crowbar, Kez Evans, who I haven't mentioned so far, but was in the PWI 500 this year, which is insane to think about. And then a couple more trips to Target, and then the world ended. So that was it. That was the world over. So when you were having your matches in February 2020, that was with, I think, your team with Dylan Thorne by that point. And you're against Kez and Thatcher. Was there any impending thought? Because the pandemic had just about started at that point, and it was a bit dodgy if things were happening and going on. So when you were having that match, was there any thought of this might be your last one for a while? Was there any possibility, or were you in the same boat as everyone else? It was just like, it's just a flu, 2 weeks and we'll be done.
I didn't think the world was ending. I thought it's something over in China, it won't get over here, it won't be that serious. It'll be like Ebola or something like that. But no, little did we know, it was much more serious.
So that was it. Yeah, world was over at that point. So how did you keep yourself occupied? I've got a question from Zardato about your body transformation, which we'll get to, but how did you keep yourself occupied during that time with no wrestling?
They still kept in contact with a lot of people through Zoom and things. We would have like watch alongs from different pay-per-views, even just random ones from years ago. And me and Darrow, we thought it'd be a good idea to get Zoom workouts going with people in the asylum. And yeah, that's what kept me fit. And obviously we had still did the, I think Andy Wilde put a lot of workouts out during that time. Joe Coffey had his training as well that he was putting online. So they all helped from the fitness side. And I had a job as a delivery driver, so I was running up and down stairs all day.
So it kept you going. Yeah, Darrow, you did put a question in, but I have seen him put in up tweets and Instagrams and that in the past, and thanking yourself for his transformation or his keeping active as well. So the two years just working out and letting other people see it and get a little bit of inspiration themselves to get moving. Was Darrow a guy that you met through the GPWA, or was he a guy that you knew and happened to start wrestling as well?
No, I knew him through WWE, GPWA. It was more of an acquaintance at first, but then during that time it became better friends.
And then now
we're tag team partners.
Of course, yes. So we'll definitely get to that. So we'll ask a question from Soldato, because that seems to me that this is when it all happens. I just put, your transformation has been amazing to watch. What are your nutrition go-tos?
I don't want to be boring and just say it's chicken and rice and that, but just starting to bring my own food into work and tracking my food.
So it's not the most exciting life, but there's results that show from it. See, I always like to say, I love chicken, I love rice, but chicken and rice just sounds like the most boring thing in the world. But it clearly must work, because all these ripped wrestlers and people in general always swear by it. I'm just like, it's just taste. Do you have seasoning?
Yeah, get lots of seasoning. And also just started to eat more. Like, I was more concerned about getting lean before, but then I started trying to get bigger. Obviously, I'm called Big Ross, so I want to get bigger. And that's a bonus with it.
Always before we off things like corn. I tried corn, and it is the most... Oh, corn mince is the most vilest thing I've ever tasted, because it just tastes like nothing, and nothing but bad at the same time. So rice and chicken with loads of seasoning, I could do that. That's easy. I can write that down. Why not? And I put on the lockdown 2 stone and then some. So I'm going to need to find. I'm wearing black or thin or bigger t-shirts to make me look slimmer now. That's the thought process behind it. But yeah, so that and did you have, so you had access to the asylum to do workouts, or did you have your kind of like a home gym as well, all ready to go during this lockdown?
Yeah, it was just a home gym. I had loads of resistance bands and a few light dumbbells. Then a pack of cards to do card workouts.
Any particular workout that came, if you drew out the cards and it came down, did you think, why did I put this in the list? That was just the worst. Right, okay. I'm just going to agree because I have no idea. I don't think I know what burpee is, other than when I drink my fizzy juice too fast. I'm happy to not know. That's all right. Yeah, I'm happy to not know at this stage. So yeah, you had that. You had this. I said you got leaner, and because you're bigger, it always helps being big and lean, and you're able to lift bigger people and throw them further as well. Then eventually, shows have come back. So as of recording, October 2021 was when it was your return. Well, before that, I don't know how I've written it all the way down in my list here. You made an ICW debut, November 19. I think that's a bit more important in our timeline here. So it was in the pre-show Battle Royal for Fear and Loathing 12, I've got here. So it's for, of course, for the VIP ticket holders, but this is an ICW debut, regardless of how you want to cut it. So when did you find out that you were going to be in? If I remember rightly, you weren't even announced for the match, were you? And you just...
No, I made my entrance from ringside because I was in my security gear at the time.
So what was it like making your actual ICW debut, and there would have been people in the crowd who would have known who you were, and here you are. SWG3, that was that one. Yeah. So you're in ICW. So how'd that feel?
Well, on the night when I made my way down to ringside, there was people in the crowd asking me, like, well, are you not the surprise entrant? I thought it'd be you. It is what it is. Just saying to them things like that, shrugging it off. And then it happens, and I wasn't sure how big a reaction I would get, but it wasn't bigger than anything I could have imagined. And then I was the last person eliminated by Paxo, and I get the most eliminations in that rumble. So yeah, it was a pretty good debut.
Get the Kane run, Kane 2001 rumble run.
That was my first thought as well.
So were you working crew like beforehand, and how was it like actually being to work at an ICW show? So this is your first Scottish show, seeing an ICW show at the garage, and now you're actually ringside crew working these events. Was it a bit surreal, or was there any particular moments that you couldn't believe you're being part of?
Well, from just being ringside?
Just being involved in some way, whether it's a pull apart or just being there for it.
Biggest one would be being ringside at the SECC show and feeling how loud the crowd were that night, and for like Grado versus Drew, and the Hydro shows were loud. That first Hydro show was surreal. Although I actually injured my knee catching Ricochet that night.
Is that when they went from the top rope into the crowd?
That was
phenomenal. Everyone else came out unscathed, including the wrestlers, except yourself.
Yes.
No, that must be insane to think that, pardon the pun, but that you went from seeing ICW in the second annual Square Go in the garage, and now you're part of it, even in a little way, even if it's security, it's still a very important part of the actual show. But you're now standing in the Hydro, watching, was it 6,000 that first one, four, six, something like that, 6,000 people, and you're getting paid to be there, or you're at least part of the show. So is that probably, as far as maybe not an in-ring perspective, is that probably one of your highlights just in your wrestling career so far?
Yeah, just being present at those shows. Yeah, definitely. Because, say, Grado and Drew was the loudest I've ever heard a crowd.
And then the year after was Joe Angle, wasn't it? The mm-hmm. year after, so it's still something to be part of. So yeah, I can't believe I almost got to this year and hadn't even spoken about ICW at all. So you made it to the final two. Were you given feedback? Was there anyone from your coaches that took you aside and were able to give you feedback on that match afterwards and
things like that? Yeah, a few of them watched it and made a few small things, obviously, and there's mostly good feedback.
So we're fast forward then, October 2021. You're back. It's Community Pro Wrestling set up by Ravy Davey for Govan, which is an insane crowd. I don't know how it was for CPW, but I'm assuming absolutely nuts.
It was insane.
Yeah, they're a bit feral down in Govan when it comes to wrestling. I've heard and saw on YouTube.
Bring your riot gear.
I can't imagine being there for it. So you end up in two matches that night. You had your Terminator Open Challenge, and it was Spider Bomb that answered it. So I do have a question about Terminator, so I'm not gonna get away with that. But so when you found out CPW's come back, Ravy Davies approached you. We've got this. You're gonna have an open challenge. Were you given plenty of notice? What was your kind of routine from that point? Were you getting into, I don't know, iron girders, or were you getting into the asylum and just
working? Yeah, we're in iron girders quite a lot. Yeah.
And getting prepared for it. So Spider Bomb. Of course you had a match afterwards, but being in Govan in general, I said, right gear, it's a crazy crowd, but how did it feel getting in front of a crowd after, at this point, it would have been 20 months or something like that. What was it like getting in front of a crowd again?
Oh, it was unbelievable, especially that crowd. Because, like, when I made the challenge and I was talking to Spider Bam in the microphone, I could hardly get a word in because the crowd were so loud for him.
Yeah, it's I can't remember how I've described it in the past. That's just from watching a Source show. They just look like they're high on sugar and just aggression.
When I see Spider Bam, I've never been booed that much in my life.
Of course, that led to a tag team match with Spider Bam and Darrow, who we've mentioned as well, against HD Drake. Which when I was going through the results, when I saw that popped up, I thought that's a fairly random person to have in this. But anyway, and Casino Brutal, so Mikey Devine and Rabo Romero. So it's a lot of GPWA guys. Anyway, people that you've been in the ring with and interacted with. So, what was it like? So you had your booed tremendously by the governed crowd, and now you've got to kind of get them on side as well. So that must have been a bit of a challenge for you that evening.
I think as soon as they seen that I was that Spider Bam had earned my respect, because it was a bit difficult to beat, then they came out and I pretty much told them, come with me if you want to live, and then Darrow came out and we made a team, a Terminator, a Spider Bam and a Super Saiyan. What a duo.
Wrestling, isn't it? That's just wrestling all over. So in interim of that, of course, you're announced to be Pro 2 as well.
Yes.
So you are Pro 2.
I am Pro 2.
How did that get set up then? Because I hear either stories, people send their CV to Logan, and he comes back with this amazing idea and a bunch of ideas to get you going, or he'll come to you with an idea and that's how it comes to be. So how did you become Pro 2?
It was through Big John Urban, because he did the security at Pro Wrestling Elite. And quite a lot of I was helping him with that, and he just told me and message Logan, he's looking for guys and I think it'd be good for it, so I did, and then Here I am, Pro 2.
So yeah, I've seen their shows have just taken place this past weekend as a recording, and yeah, it seems like he's got something. It's got something there in air, and it's also a nice way, because of course if you're doing the pre-shows in air for PWE, then there's a little bit of familiarity hopefully with a crossover audience, that they'll know who you are when you get there and what have you. And of course there's very few guys of your stature in Scotland anyway, so it's also another big plus for all of that. So we mentioned Terminator. I'll just ask the question now. Favorite Terminator film?
Judgment Day.
All right, and that's, yeah. I mean, is there any better one after that? It's just the first two seem to be so good. Nothing. Yeah,
the third one is okay. Third one is acceptable, but the first two are the best.
I remember I watched Salvation in the cinema. It was the worst experience of my life.
Although the Terminator films aren't even my favorite Schwarzenegger film.
All right, okay then. What would it be? What's your Schwarzenegger franchise or
Total
film?
Recall.
All right, okay. I thought you were just going to go absolutely off the wall and go Twins or something, or
yeah,
Kindergarten
Total
Cop.
Recall, Kindergarten Cop, Commando, Last Action Hero, Predator.
Oh, yeah, Last Action Hero somehow is my Christmas movie of choice. After Jingle All the Way, of course, that has to be.
Last Action Hero is like a parody of what an 80s action film is.
It's incredible. I said I wouldn't tell embarrassing stories for my wife when she hates the film, mainly because there was one Christmas, I don't know how, but we went to three different houses. Every time I went in there, it was on, and I just sat and ignored everyone and was watching Last Action Hero. I saw that film so many times in clips that weekend, that Christmas morning and weekend. It was just... it was the best. It was just so. It's one of those. This, if you think about it too much, it's a terrible film. But if you switch off and just enjoy it, that's the best way to live.
That's how you should watch a film.
Oh yeah, same with wrestling. That's how you should watch wrestling as well. Yeah. Just switch off, enjoy it. Don't think about it. It's like, oh, why is Spider-Man getting beaten up? Just don't think about it. Don't think about it. Just enjoy what you're seeing. Yeah. Or boo.
I know. Almost forgot one of my favorite Christmas films, Jingle All the Way.
Yeah, it's the best. Is there you're going for the Terminator open. Is there any thought of doing a Turbo Man open around about Christmas if there's a show around about then?
If there's a Christmas show, then perhaps.
I've now seen these Turbo Man dolls coming out in shops. I don't remember them coming out at the time. I don't know who they're... Have you got a Turbo Man? Have you got one eyed up? Have you seen one?
No, I don't. I get told that was based off of the Buzz Lightyear dolls when they came out.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, that, absolutely. I kind of want to watch Jingle All the Way now. When this comes out, it'll be December, so it'll be fine. Everyone go watch it after we've done this chat.
It's always the first Christmas film I watch every year.
Unfortunately, ours is Nightmare Before Christmas, but that's only because it's acceptable to watch it in October. So it's technically the first one you want.
And a November film.
Yeah, aye, well, just in the middle. You can have a bit of both. But yeah, so there's quite a few big Terminator fans around in Scottish wrestling, or Schwarzenegger fans in general, likes of Big Cav as well, I think. Does DCT has a bit of a affinity?
Yeah, he did a podcast, the Arnie Appreciation Society.
That's what I remember. So have you been able to sit down with DCT at all and been able to hash out your thoughts on Schwarzenegger films?
Not really the chance to do that, no.
I'm not saying that you want to kind of nudge Ravy Davy to book DCT for the next CPW show, but I mean, there you go. That's any reason for Arnie appreciation. That's it. Of course, wrestling would be good as well. Okay, so you've kind of taken on the Terminator Open. Was that in that break in between not wrestling? Was that your thought of kind of maybe freshen up the character a little bit, just add a little bit lick of paint to yourself, Big Ross, or what was your kind of thoughts behind it?
Yeah, well, I listen to a lot of podcasts that are like a wrestler's better if they can get called, like, if they can have a moniker, then I just thought, well, would be a good one for me. I was like, the Terminator. So,
have you got the sunglasses, leather jacket, boots, coat, motorcycle?
Yeah, not quite a motorcycle, though.
That's next. That's it. That's a new year. You can get an entrance into the Fairfield Club.
If I'm in a street fight or anything in the future, I'll come out wearing all that.
Oh, I can't wait. That sounds amazing. Right, so I've got a couple of our own stupid questions, which you may know about because you said just list a couple of episodes. First one's, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Does a Luchasaurus count?
It does. Absolutely. Luchasaurus does count, and it's outside the box, which is always better. Luchasaurus, and the other question we ask is, what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep or one cow. I think it would take more than two sheep to beat one cow. So I'm going to say the cow.
All right, I'll take your word for it. I'm still on team two sheep, but you know, we'll never find out. And I don't really want to find out. I think that would just be sad to watch two sheep fight a cow. And just there'll be no winners except maybe me in the background going, told you if sheep win. Right, so do have a question from Ravy Davy, but we'll keep that one to the end because I'm trying to make a new thing for the last question. What's your plans for wrestling now it's back? Is there any, have you got like a 5-year plan? Have you got a list of opponents you want to get in the ring with? Any promotions you want to get to?
Well, I want to be in every community pro wrestling show. Want to be in Pro 2 regularly and want to go back to Target. Those are the main ones that I'm thinking of. Obviously the usual ones, obviously Wrestle Experience Scotland and ICW. If I get the call for that, then
So it's just getting back to it, really. Just mm-hmm. being able to wrestle and it grow and what have you. So any opponents at all that you'd want to get in with?
Just in Scotland or?
Well, Ravy's question is kind of dream match, so we'll leave that one just to the side a bit. But once it could happen in the next however long, 12 months, three years, whatever.
I've never had a match with Leighton Buzzard. So we'll say that for starters. Anyone else?
So, Andy Wilde or something?
Well, just... me and Levi are due a rematch at the Target tag team titles. Because Medallion and Ivy jumped us and beat us that way.
So it's a bit of a titles in your plan for titles in your future, then get up first belt.
I suppose always the bigger opponents like Andy Wilde.
Then got like a demo back coming back in the
country. Yeah, now the demo's well. Back. Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay. So last question is, like, we do social media afterwards. That's the last bit. But Davey's asked, well, who's your dream match? And I'll just add a little bit extra to it because I'm trying to make this last question, which is you've been given the book, you've got the main event of WrestleMania, you get to pick your opponent, who would it be?
If it's WrestleMania, then maybe a common answer, but maybe Mr. WrestleMania, Shawn Michaels.
Good, grab him out of retirement. Absolutely.
Or if we go back 10 years or so to JBL, or we're talking now, maybe now that he lost the AEW belt, could have a Terminator v Terminator with Kenny Omega.
4-way, there you go, here's your main event. Big Ross, JBL, Shawn Michaels, Kenny Omega. There's your marquee, that's WrestleMania for you. Yeah, so well, I think we've kind of went through, we've sped through Big Ross's career in wrestling so far, and you've got kind of things planned in the future. Outside of wrestling, though, what's your kind of passions? You said, Arnie, I know I say the WrestleMania questions last, but plans always change when I'm doing these things. What's your passions outside of wrestling? Say, like, Arnie films, have you got, are you a collector of anything? Or are you just a watcher of particular things? What's your passions?
Arnie, Star Wars, Marvel. A few types of films that I like.
Star Wars, I'm all right with, but Marvel's always going to be a one to take. So, what's your favorite Marvel film?
There's so many.
I know. At this stage.
I always like the Iron Man series, and Guardians of the Galaxy. I'd say the big films, Endgame, Infinity War. Mm-hmm. And I'm liking the new ones as well. I really like Shang-Chi.
Yeah, I watched that again just a couple of nights ago because it was Disney Plus Day. So, yeah.
Because of the IMAX.
Yeah. It was weird because the TV's, it's an HDTV, but it's not like 4K or anything. So I didn't get like the crispness, but I just got the extra bits either side, which was, it just looked cool. And it's still a film. Eternals, not so big on, but Shang-Chi, I loved it. It's when you say there's so many, I think I did a list with some people and there's like 30 at the moment between the films and the TV shows. And God help anyone trying to jump in and watch them now, because that's another month.
Actually, Thor Ragnarok is probably one of my favourites too.
Hmm. Yeah.
Just for Thor going God mode in the fridge.
Oh yeah, the immigration song in the background. Amazing. Absolutely. Anyway, yeah. So again, I'm always afraid that this becomes just a Marvel podcast. So we'll wrap things up there. So where can people find out about Big Ross on the social media?
Is Neil look at my own social media?
I will have a help.
So on Instagram, I am just Ross Hauser. And on Twitter, I am at Ross Hauser 25. On Facebook, I am. And on TikTok, I am also Ross Hauser.
TikTok? Have you been putting up TikToks, or are you just a watcher of TikToks?
I've put up a few TikToks.
There you go. So, yeah.
With Titanic music.
There we go then. So if you've learned anything, if you've gotten this far in the podcast, one, you need to go watch Last Action Hero or Jingle All the Way Now. That's just, you have to do it. And go follow Ross on TikTok. And by this point, you may have done one of the trending dances. Who knows? But no, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me today.
Thank you very much for having me. It was a pleasure.